Hey, everybody. Welcome to Roger and Me, a.k.a. Roger Ebert and Me, a movie review podcast tribute to Siskel and Ebert, in which two film critics, myself, Brett Arnold, and Mark Dujsik of MarkReviewsMovies.com, veteran film critic Mark Dujsik. Let's add another adjective to that, because we have to distinguish me from you somehow. We're just two bald guys who talk about all the movies that come out every Friday. The goal is to talk about everything that comes out theatrically, on streaming, on VOD. We aim to cover all of it this week. Not bad. I think we've got 8 on the podcast, which means Mark and I both saw 8. And if you go to MarkReviewsMovies.com, I always have to give it a plug. Mark's got 13 for this week. I'm trying to look at what I skipped. I know that there's a couple, or maybe just one documentary and a couple other smaller films that if you want to know more about, check out MarkReviewsMovies.com. There is a movie I saw in January at a festival that Mark reviewed for this week that I did not catch up with again because it was quite unremarkable. And if you read Mark's review, you will find that he agrees. So I didn't do my due diligence. I didn't do my homework and rewatch Everyone Will Burn, but you can read about it on MarkReviewsMovies.com. Go to Apple Podcasts. Leave us a review, please. It helps the podcast a lot. Please leave us reviews on Apple Podcasts. 5 stars only. We don't accept anything less than that, actually. It'll actually break your computer or phone if you try to do that. So don't even try. Just give us 5 stars. Write us a nice little blurb. I'll read it and go, I feel validated for doing this show that takes up a great chunk of my life for no money. What do people look for in life? Money? I don't know. But we do it for the pride of watching all the movies. We love movies here at the show. This week, we've got 8 of them. And I'm trying to think of off the top of my head how many are good. I'm going to go ahead and say about half. Half of these movies are good. And that's a good ratio. That's 4. You go into a weekend with 4 movies to watch. That's overwhelming. So sorry to overwhelm you. Mark, what's going on?
Not much. Just excited. I mean, we're hitting a good stride, and it's coming up on the end of the year, which is a very, very busy time.
Very busy time. The screeners are out, so the film critics are watching everything that comes out over the course of the next month, over the course of like the first week of December, the last couple weeks of November, cramming to make their end of the year lists. So Mark and I have seen most movies that are coming out by the end of the year, except
I'm a little behind.
Okay, yeah,
I'm a little behind from you. You've seen more than I have.
Ooh,
the end of the year. Yeah. This coming week is gonna be. I'm gonna be just sitting in front of the TV with movies nonstop, pretty much. So it'll be fun.
What a life! That's why we do.
And that part I do entirely for free. There is no, there's no reason for me to catch up with these movies this early, except for awards.
Yeah, you want to get your voice heard.
Yeah.
For sure. What do we got here? The first movie of the week, I'm so excited to talk about it. It's a new Godzilla movie, a new Japanese Godzilla movie, specifically. There's so much to talk about with regard to this movie and with regard to the Godzilla franchise. So let's get right into it with the trailer for Godzilla Minus One. Oh, man, I'm very excited to talk about this movie. One of the coolest things about it, Mark, that I clocked right away while I was watching the movie is how it wears its influences on its sleeve in a way that I really appreciate. Like, there's an entire set piece, almost the first act of the movie, that is just like, hey, we're going to do Jaws, but it's Godzilla. And then there's a third act set piece that's like, what if we did Dunkirk? But it was Godzilla. And then the middle set piece is just, what if Godzilla was Godzilla and did a Godzilla attacking a city thing? So I thought it just delivered in terms of amazing, badass, epic, cool to look at, visually pleasing spectacle set pieces. And Mark, when I tell you my mind exploded when I read that the budget for this movie was $15 million. And the fact that this movie, if it were made in America, would cost $200, $150 conservatively, it just boggles the mind to think where all that money is going. But that's a different conversation. I really appreciated the earnest melodrama of this movie after the biting government bureaucracy satire of the last Japanese Godzilla movie from, God, what was it, 2016? Shin Godzilla. Fantastic movie. It's like, what if Godzilla was happening and you were watching like a the thick of it or in the loop style satire of government bureaucracy? But this movie has the same kind of the government's not going to save you message. It's just operated completely differently, coming from a totally different angle. The message of this movie is like, the government's not going to save you. It's up to the citizens to organize and save themselves. So I think these movies really complement each other. I think it's maybe one of the best Godzilla movies I've ever seen, which, you know, there's 70 years of these movies now. I think this is number 30 something, maybe even more than that. I thought it was fantastic. What did you think?
I liked it quite a bit too, for a lot of the reasons that you brought up. And I'm iffy on Shin Godzilla just because I think that the government bureaucracy satire gets a little thin as it goes on.
It's a long movie, and there's a lot of that stuff. Yeah,
it's repetitive in terms of the satire. It's just over and over again. Nobody can.
But
do
what about the
about
googly-eyed? What about googly?
Oh yeah, I love Godzilla. Yeah, I love Godzilla in that because he's so weird at times as he evolves. This one though, because it is returning to that idea of the human story, this feels at times like a beat-for-beat remake of the 54 original film. Yes. There are action scenes and things that happen that are directly ripped from it. Like the reporter on the rooftop is like the reporters in the tower. The train getting eaten is, one, looks amazing and it's terrifying in this one, but that's also from the original. And that's the thing about Godzilla here, is he is just this unstoppable force, uncaring, unsympathetic, obviously, just not even noticing all of the buildings he's knocking down and people he's stepping on. That's what makes it so scary. And that original film is terrifying because, I mean, this is old hat at this point, but, you know, the original Godzilla was a response to nuclear weapons testing going on and all the fears of what nuclear proliferation would do. This one has a direct reference to the atomic bomb attack in either Hiroshima or Nagasaki when Godzilla unleashes his atomic breath for the first time. And it is horrifying to watch that.
It is stunning. I saw it. Did you see it in? I saw it in.
I saw it in
IMAX.
Dolby. Yeah, I saw it in Dolby,
right?
Theater.
That sound, that moment where it's like, it's like almost the same sound cue thing from Oppenheimer when the bomb goes off. Where it's like the delayed sound, but it's the loudest thing you've ever heard. And it, like, you felt the impact of it. And it was really cool to see. And again, $15 million budget versus like
I can't
Godzilla
that.
Versus Kong costing, I don't even want to look, probably 200 and
a
like,
lot of money.
It just, these movies eat American blockbusters lunch, dude. Like, it is embarrassing to watch American blockbusters after something like this.
Yeah, this looks fantastic, and to hear that the budget is that low, I can't imagine it. I have to assume that there's a lot of in-house, because the filmmaker...
There's like eight people. There's eight people on the VFX team, where like in the U.S. it would be like, what, hundreds? It's just like it's about like a vision. People in my... I've tweeted about this, so I've been getting a bunch of VFX people tweeting at me, explaining why it's going on, like why it's different in there and here. And a lot of it is just the amount of time spent in pre-production planning these things and making it look good versus Marvel strategy, which is to change the script on the fly and just constantly change things. So the overages come from like overworked people. They come from doing sequences and then doing them again and redoing them. But everyone stressed that, like, clearly this movie, Godzilla Minus One, had like, and it showed in the trailer, actually, the guy who wrote and directed it did the VFX. It must be like a VFX guy, because it's like, you need like an auteur level VFX guy with a vision for what it looks like, and you can do anything, is what they all are telling me. They're like, if you have that and you have the team, it can be small and, you know, not that much money, and you can make it sing. And this movie is a great example of that. But you're right. This movie is a lot like the 54. I love, oh God, when the theme kicks in, like an hour in,
yeah,
that's the theme, the iconic theme. Oh my God, I lost it. But yeah, I think it's really powerful stuff because it has like the human drama on the ground that all, it's melodrama for sure, but it's pitched very well and it works. And you really feel the action, the set pieces. The first one, I heard someone compare to Jurassic Park and I was like, oh yeah, that's a good call. Because it's basically Godzilla's a little, just like a dinosaur sized thing early on and just kind of wrecking people. And then he gets atomic bombed or whatever, and just keeps growing and growing. And it's just so cool. I'm so eager for people to see it. I hope it's like a huge hit. I don't know how huge a hit it can be. I hope it's getting a wide release.
It's a wide release for sure. But I don't know how many people are going to go out and go see an actual subtitled Godzilla movie now. I would hope a good number of people would, but who knows? Yeah, the fact that it's so centered on the human characters, which is refreshing. Yeah. And the human characters matter. Like, this is about a kamikaze pilot who bailed on his mission at the last minute because he didn't want to die and ends up in Tokyo in a post-firebombed, air-raided Tokyo and is just trying to get through his life and trying to get over the guilt of having left behind his family, left his family to die, didn't accomplish the one mission that he was supposed to accomplish, and then got a whole bunch of people killed because he was too scared to fight off Godzilla. All of this survivor's guilt and trauma and regret, you feel it, even if it is all melodrama. It doesn't matter because this is,
you know why it works?
That's the sense of that country at the time.
Exactly. That's exactly what I was just going to say. Because like, it's about, this movie's about how the government treated their own people. They like treated them as bullet casings to be shot into war. Like these kamikaze pilots, it's such a compelling opening because this kamikaze pilot is landing for repairs and you quickly realize like there's nothing wrong with this plane. This guy is just, it's the last days of the war. So like it's already over and these people are still, their order is to go kill themselves for the country for no reason at this point. So this guy doesn't do it. And yeah, the movie's about that. And like Godzilla is used in the way it often is as like a specter of a metaphor type of thing that like is lording over him, that represents his, you know, all the things you're saying. It represents all the things he's running from. And like the way that really works and the way that the payoff is great. The third act had the audience, I saw it with, applauding like at that one moment. It just, it's such a good crowd pleaser, but it very much is a Godzilla movie with a statement about Japan at the, you know, the Japanese government, and it has something to say and it has a message and it's about the power of the collective human, but also like it makes sure to show you how like helpless they are in the face of something like this created, you know, by the American testing or whatever. But it's definitely not giving, like, it's definitely, I thought, I was surprised by the degree to which it took Japan to task, I guess. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, and just the level of basic humanity, that third act, you expect that third act to kind of be another big city destruction scene. And the whole plan is revolving around avoiding that, avoiding the spectacle that we want just to be able to save more human lives and save every human life. Every human life here matters to the characters by the end. And that's important for that message of survival as a collective, as just human beings, basic human beings wanting to survive and to get through all the troubles that we have and everything. It's a powerful message in a Godzilla movie, which I wasn't expecting. I really thought that third act was going to be, oh, Godzilla shows up again, but it takes a completely different turn. And I really appreciated the fact that it's using that last action set piece as a way to communicate that message on a deeper level. It's really nice.
Yeah. And like my buddy Charles Bermesco's tweet about it was like, Sergei Eisenstein would love this movie. And I love that. I love that take because, you know, of course, populist leanings going on, all that stuff. But just like he's right about the rousing montage and action that this movie has that makes you, it's just the perfect use of that, of film editing, I guess, is what I would say. Really cross-cutting, all that stuff. It is a really, really great movie. And I don't know why I'm not giving it 4 stars, but I am giving it 3.5 stars. I think it's fantastic.
Oh, cool. Yeah. I'm giving it a very, very solid 3 stars. It's really good, though.
Really good stuff. Definitely check it out. It wasn't until that trailer that I even understood or attempted to understand what the title meant. The trailer's like, Japan is zero. Now it is -1. So like after the war, Japan was zero. And now it's worse because Godzilla is there, I guess.
It has the sense of being like a countdown almost, like, you know, T-1, T-, whatever. But it also is, I'm also wondering if it's a reference to the fact that, you know, in the actual official Godzilla timeline, Godzilla doesn't show up until around 1954. And this one, this is taking it back before Godzilla.
So truly, like, you could read it as like prequel to original Godzilla.
Kind of, yeah.
Which I think is cool. That is awesome. It's a great movie. It's playing wider than any, you know, foreign Godzilla movie has been playing in America, as far as I can tell. It's getting a very wide release. I had the AMC early access push, which in New York City, almost every show was full. They actually added a second round of late night shows that night.
Yeah, they did.
That was so well.
Yeah.
Very cool to see. Hope people see it. I don't know. It's so funny when people like, when I talk about movies and how, why I love them and how and when it started, I just always go with, you know, all my memories are tied to movies. Like, I can't tell you a lot about my childhood, but my example is always, I can tell you where I sat and what I ate when I saw Godzilla 1998, the Roland Emmerich movie. So like, even that's a bad movie, to be clear, but like,
yes,
I was 7 or 8 years old. It was awesome. What do you mean it was bad? You couldn't tell me it was bad back in the day. So it is nice to have actually good ones happening. Because I think Shin Godzilla is one of my favorites. This is one of my favorites. 54 is obviously the best one and probably won't be beat. But like, you're not going to have guys in rubber suits anymore. And it has like a different charm that they are now completely different CGI spectacles. But Monsterverse put to shame by this movie, I will say. The U.S. Monsterverse. And yet, well, you will hear us on, what's that one called? The new Godzilla versus Kong, whatever that is.
It's like we'll Kong talk about it cross Godzilla or whatever.
Yeah, there's some sort of X. I don't know what's going on. But we'll talk about
the title when it comes out. I know that much.
For sure. We'll see what they end up going with in the final ads. I feel like they could just change it last minute, too. Who knows? Godzilla versus Kong was actually a surprise.
I think it's fun.
Yeah,
it's
it was fun. It's a fun one after a bunch of duds, in my opinion. But the 2014 was also good too. I guess I didn't like King of the Monsters. Skull Island was a gen. Yeah. I didn't like that much either. All right, enough about Godzilla. Clearly passionate about Godzilla. There were so many Godzilla heads at the screening, like people wearing merch and like stuff. It was cool. All right, Silent Night, the latest John Woo movie, which I excitedly went to see in person at a screening, and it was just a very bad experience. This movie's really not good. Here's the trailer.
Shots fired.
All units, please respond.
This is your basic revenge thriller, and the gimmick is that there's like one line of repeated dialogue, very whispered and hushed, that doesn't need to be there, but also kind of throws everything off. Anyway, beyond that, it's just a guy, his kid is killed in a crossfire in a gang fight, and then he decides after, you know, drinking himself in the garage, drinking himself to, you know, misery in the garage, and his wife ends up leaving him, to go and kill all the people who were involved in the death of his son. And that's it. The whole movie is, a lot of the movie is a training montage extended to feature length, which is a very odd decision for a movie that doesn't have any dialogue. So we're just watching this guy get ready to kill a bunch of people. And then the last 30 or 40 minutes or so is an extended action set piece in car chases and shootouts, and
which sounds great on paper. John Woo's
in
here,
theory, yeah,
but it doesn't hit. It doesn't hit, right? Why doesn't it?
It doesn't hit because, I mean, there's nothing, there's no human element to this. When you don't have the dialogue, you need to have something going on. And instead of focusing on the character and his actual life post having his son killed, it's just him being miserable and then being determined. And occasionally being sad when he has those sappy flashbacks of the sun with happier days. It's like, that's the only human element here.
That got a big laugh in the room of three people that I saw this in, when like the really sappy flashback.
Which one?
yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah, it's pitched like a Hallmark movie. Like that, I can't describe it any other way, because all those scenes come off like they don't. None of this movie has the like John Woo flavor that's needed to make up for all the crap we're talking about and all the boring derivative setup. There's just nothing to it at all. So the things you're talking about, like the final act or whatever, that's all action. On paper, I'm like, I don't care how bad the movie is. John Woo directed that. It must be awesome. But there's next to no John Woo flourishes. There's barely anything to make this a Christmas movie at all besides like the fucking title. That's it. I really don't know. Some decor in the background.
Gets killed on Christmas Eve, and he decides to kill them all on Christmas. He puts it in the calendar. Like, he's going to forget. That's just for us.
That is the tone that I think the movie should have been the whole time, maybe. Like, the it cuts to a December 24th calendar, and it says kill them all. Like, that's the tone I want it to be, but it feels like it's not that tone. Like, it's really earnest and sad and trying to be a heartbreaking melodrama about this guy's family. But it doesn't hit because it's the most derivative thing we've seen 1,000 times. Guy whose kid is killed, he gets revenge. It's Death Wish. It's exactly Death Wish. And it's exactly Death Wish in like the modern way it was remade by Eli Roth or any other knockoffs, where it's like very reactionary. Well, I guess it's always been reactionary. But it's very, you know, gangs are infiltrating your neighborhood and you've got to pick up guns and kill them. Like, it's very reactionary in a way I wasn't expecting, and it didn't work for me here because the movie around it sucks. Like, that action, there's nothing. I don't remember any of it. I saw it a month ago. I don't remember anything about this movie.
The stairway climb I thought was really well done, where he's just climbing that winding staircase and it's a faux one take. You can tell where all the cuts are, but I didn't really care that much because I think it's staged well, and I thought the way that they implemented the cuts with the choreography was clever. But that's about it. Otherwise, there's a scene where a character picks up two pistols and starts rapid firing. I'm like, oh, that guy must watch a lot of John Woo movies. But this is a John Woo movie. We want to see that kind of inspiration of action, not just kind of repeating itself over and over again.
And there's none of that balletic like setup or at all. It's so badly paced. The villains are so not even there on the page, right? They're just like, everything about this feels
no
like
no one's
just,
there on the page. There's no one talking.
No. It feels so half written, though. Even like, it feel like they would double their, you know, they would do a really good job writing things because there's no dialogue. But instead, they're just like, generic fucking Mexican gangbangers or whatever the fuck it is. And every element is the archetypal placeholder that they didn't write around. They just left it in. It feels like a dummy script that they could have judged up a little bit, but instead they just left the bare bones thing. It's like a bare bones outline on which you write a better movie onto, but it's just there. I don't know. It's a really bad movie. I was very disappointed with it. I guess Woo's last movie was also a disappointing Netflix movie before this, so I don't know why I was excited. But like, John Woo, I'm a Mission Impossible 2 defender. I don't think, you know, Face Off or Hard Boy, like, a lot of them don't need defending, like Hard Target and Face Off and stuff like that. But like, Wind Talkers, I think, is great. I think John Woo's a very interesting guy. I haven't seen all of the Hong Kong movies, obviously, but I've seen the American ones. And as far as American ones go, this is by far the worst one. It's really bad. 1.5 for me.
Oh, I'm giving it 2. And that is because I think some of the action is, you know, it's well done by the end. But it's,
if you say so, I don't remember
I know. I'm going to say so, but I mean, it does get repetitive because there's nothing to latch onto here except that formulaic plot we all know, and no human characters to listen to or to understand on any kind of level. Just it's
a plot we all know, yet they spend 70 minutes setting it up. It's like the whole first. The first hour of the movie is setting up a thing that you already got from like the 2 seconds of flashback.
You get to watch him get better at driving, get better at shooting, get better at fighting. Feels like it was written for those people who write like make like 4-hour YouTube videos picking apart an hour and a half movie and all the supposed plot holes in it. Like, you have to see him get better at everything. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense that he could get better at it. That's what it feels like. And it's annoying. That's not interesting to watch. I don't care how he gets better at shooting a gun. I care that he's suffering and that his marriage is falling apart because he can't realize it. That's more interesting than, hey, look, this is how he learns to drive donuts in a parking lot.
Yeah, very uninspired, very disappointing. If you were expecting like a return to form for John Woo, I'm sorry. There are people on Twitter. You can find them. There are people on Twitter who think it is, and I think they must have seen a different movie than me, or they like hit their head on the way in or something. But you can find that take if you want it. All right, here is... Sorry, I like to rope Mark into my really incendiary shit. Like,
that's okay,
we feel this way. Moving on.
I give it a 2 stars. I don't remember if I said it. I'm slightly more positive on it.
Slightly more
but positive. Not positive in general.
Well, speaking of positive in general, let's move on to Eileen, a movie I saw at Sundance in January and did rewatch for the podcast this week because it's kind of great, and I was hesitating, but I'm not going to hesitate.
I'll take over that position. It's kind of great.
It's kind of great. It's very good at the very least. Here is the trailer.
Eileen.
Oh, look what the cat dragged in.
Good afternoon, Eileen.
How's your day, Dad?
It was a day, just another day.
My day was a doozy. It's one of those days you never forget.
Listen up. This young lady is our new prison psychologist. She may be easy on the eyes, but I assure you, she is very smart.
I'm Rebecca.
I know. I don't think I caught your name.
Oopsie. Nasty habit. That's why I like it. I live alone.
I'll stop it there because I don't know how much the trailer gives away. And this movie is very much about, I'm not even going to say anything. There's a heel turn and you don't want it revealed, I guess, is all I will tease about it. One of the coolest things about this movie, and you get a sense of it from the trailer there, is that Anne Hathaway looks like she walked off the set of an Alfred Hitchcock movie or like an old film noir. She's like a femme fatale who walks into Eileen's life and changes it. That's basically what this movie's about. I'm not going to say in what way. This movie, at least for a while, it feels like you're watching Carol. You're watching like a lesbian romance blossom. But tell me about this movie, Mark. What did you connect
you're
with it?
Worse than me. There we go. Okay,
I have to throw this to you. I'm stumbling out the gate here.
Here's how I'll put it. I'll put it that, you know, it takes a different direction eventually, but and I think it earns it. And I think that might be a contention with some people that whether or not it earns where it goes. But like the first hour or so, it's a pretty short film, is just exploring Eileen's character and her life and her relationship with her father and how she is stuck in this life because her mother died. So she came home early from college and she wanted to go to college and she wanted to have this life. You just watch her in this prison that she cannot escape from while she literally works at a juvenile prison and caring for kids who are, you know, also stuck in this system. They committed crimes, I guess, as meager as a couple of instances of shoplifting and one as awful as a brutal murder of his father.
Yeah.
That comes into play later. But I just was so caught up in this character. And it's not just her life. You also get a look inside of her mind. And so you have all of these scenes of her daydreaming or actually dreaming of inflicting harm on herself or on her father or just in some vague way. And you really get this sense of just how imprisoned she is in her own body, in her own life, in her own mind. And I was so caught up in it. And a lot of it has to do with Mackenzie's performance because the character is very quiet. And so it relies a lot on Mackenzie just very effectively and very evocatively communicating things with her face in a very subtle way. There's nothing like over the top about this performance, except maybe the accent because it's Massachusetts. It's set in Massachusetts at Christmas. And so it has that look too of just being this almost sort of Americana-ish, but twisted to this level.
Oh yeah, great Massachusetts photography.
The cinematography is just beautiful in that bleak and desolate way, like that scene
wintery,
outside the bar.
Very wintry, yes.
There's that shot outside the bar where the two of them are smoking a cigarette after they've drunk for a bit, and it's just snowing, the snow's coming down, you see the bar light. It looks like something out of a Rockefeller painting, if Rockefeller, you know, had a very dark moment. So I guess, like, what I mean is it looks like an Edward Hopper painting. That's the equivalent of it. Yes. But it's beautiful. The whole film looks beautiful, and it's acted so well. You have Mackenzie, you have Anne Hathaway, who's great as the femme fatale, who's obviously got something else going on there. And then Shea Whigham. I have to look it up.
I always say Whigham. Yeah.
Whigham. Shea Whigham, who's great. Such a great character actor. And he's really good here as the alcoholic,
the
potentially abusive father.
Oh, like just if not abusive.
Is that he's definitely emotionally abusive.
Definitely so, yes. Verbally abusive. He is just constantly being like, "You're a nobody. You'll always be a nobody." Is it him that says, "Some people are people, like in movies, the stars. Other people are just there. Take a penny, leave a penny. Like that's you." Yeah. I wrote down so many fucking lines in this movie because those lines from Shay just docking her down and nagging her are contrasted with, you know, Anne Hathaway showing up and being like a breath of fresh air and being like, "I bet you have brilliant dreams. I bet you dream of other worlds. And like, you remind me of a girl in a Dutch painting. You have a strange face. It's plain but fascinating. There's a beautiful turbulence. I love that." Like,
did write it down. Yeah.
I fucking loved it.
Great line.
It's all so good. And Anne Hathaway is having so much fun in that mode. And I think the big joy of this movie that a lot of people are maybe turned off by is the turn that eventually happens and what that says about the movie and what that says about the characters in it. And it is, I just think it's a really interesting movie, a character piece, character driven piece about like a repressed woman and what it looks like to come out of her shell. But maybe some people are, you know, have problems and should stay in their shells. Maybe. I don't know. There's a lot going on in this movie. I just don't want to get into it. It's based on a book that I'm like dying to read now.
Yeah.
And it was adapted by the author and her husband, actually, who wrote the movie. So I'm interested because it's always interesting to see a self-adaptation. And I just want to know what this looked like down the page. But like, I really, really enjoyed this movie. It's a very strong 3 for me.
Yeah, 3.5 for me. I'm stronger on it because I really enjoyed where it went. I did not see where it's going coming. And when it hit, I'm like, okay, I'm on board with this because this makes complete sense for these characters to go in that direction. And yeah.
Yeah, very cool movie. Definitely worth seeking out. Great performances and will make you want to know more. I want to read that book. All right, let's talk about a pair of streamers, a pair of holiday streaming movies. The first is on Amazon Prime. It's the second of 3 Eddie Murphy contracted at Amazon Prime films. The second after Coming to America. I don't think we know what the third one's going to be, but the second one is Candy Cane Lane, that is based on like a real street in California, and they turned it into a movie. You'll see the trailer.
It's magic. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
High stakes as neighbors compete for best decorated house on the block.
I think this is the house to beat.
Wow. What's your Christmas wish?
I just want to win this thing. I'll take it.
Signature, please. Ignore all the fine print. It's like you're signing your life away. Merry Christmas.
Yeah, Merry Christmas.
Oh, it will be.
Rise and shine, naughty boy.
What the hell is all of this?
Something's happening.
Good morning, sir.
Are you real?
We all were until we fell into that elf sick trap.
I don't think you're going to agree with me, but I didn't absolutely hate this the way I kind of expected to. I kind of thought the premise itself was inspired for a Christmas movie in terms of like the what's the song, the 12 Days of Christmas. Like the premise is some evil Christmas magic elf person makes it so the 12 Days of Christmas song is coming to life around them, which again, it sounds inspired enough to me on paper, creative enough. As someone who watches holiday movies every holiday season, you're always looking for a new perennial. I see why they thought it would work. But then functionally, when it's like, okay, the 12 Days of Christmas are around, you're just left with like very silly kind of jokes that don't amount to much. So like cows a milking, there's like a milking gag happens. There's a lot of CGI animals and birds and shit flying around. So I want to be clear, like the inspired thing stopped for me at the idea. And then the movie, they did not figure out a way to make it. So I guess it is. Does it become uninspired if it was an inspired idea, but you couldn't figure out how to make it work? So is it,
I don't know. Unimaginative. That's for sure.
That's for sure. But anyway, my summation of this movie will be words spoken by Eddie Murphy himself in this movie, which feels like it has to be self-aware, right? Where he says, "Nobody cares about hard work anymore. Crap beats quality every time," said Eddie Murphy in his second straight to Amazon piece of crap. Oh wait, I liked Coming to America.
To be clear,
you know that you were the outlier on that, right?
Yeah, I know I was.
I want to make our listeners aware of the reality of the situation.
Yeah.
Which is that Coming to America was a much derided disaster that went straight to Amazon. I was shocked when I saw it the other day when I was looking it up that you liked it. But
I did. But
anyway,
I did like this one. I did not like this one. It's a lot of lazy pun based humor. You know, the calling birds, like as soon as that clicked in my head, like why it's a parrot and why the parrot is on the phone, I cringed. And
it's very low effort
French hens. Yeah. And you know, yeah, they're French because they're wearing berets. You get it? You get it?
Yeah.
And the special effects don't look that great. This probably costs more than the entire budget of Godzilla. Put that in perspective.
1,000% true. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. This cost probably at least three times, maybe even more, the budget of Godzilla Minus One, and the special effects look like this. But beyond that, it's just boring and repetitive. Like the song, The 12 Days of Christmas. It is boring and repetitive, and it gets. It's not as annoying as the song. I'll give it that much.
Because there's nothing about it that will stick in your head. The song.
Eddie Murphy is still charming, and that's it. Enough to not look like that. You don't care that he's sleepwalking through this performance that much. He's done worse movies, and he's put more effort into worse movies. So good on him for taking a little nap in between takes on this one, and it shows. Tracy Ellis Ross, I think, is the only one who kind of comes away with some dignity. She's funny. She's naturally funny, and she's funny here in this very throwaway role as the wife who gets caught up in it. I don't know what to say. It's just a lot of chaos with the Leaping Lords, and the entire climax at the end on the street is just visual and auditory noise that I just completely lost interest in, while they're chasing rings and doing basic algebra, as you do, and you know, that festive holiday tradition of basic algebra,
crunching numbers.
My
wife was watching with me and reminded me, she was like, this is just like Jumanji. And I was like, oh, that's a good point. It's just like devolves into chaos in a town. I feel like there's also like it's trying to be like a Gremlinsy thing too, or Small Soldiers, another example. Like, I like movies that crescendo in that type of chaos, like entire town based chaos or whatever, but it just doesn't work here. And the movie gets completely overtaken with just dumb bullshit, as we keep talking about. But like, the voiceover CGI toy characters become so central to the plot. Like, I could not believe how much time we were spending with like Toy Story animated little creatures that were just talking. But you know, I appreciated David Alan Grier as Black Santa, I guess. That was enjoyable.
That should have been a much more fun.
That should have been the movie, maybe.
That should have been the movie. Let's be honest here.
David Alan Grier is Black Santa coming to Amazon Prime. Much better movie.
I mean, we had Little Rel Howery. I know you didn't see it, but Dashing Through the Snow, Little Rel Howery plays Santa, and that's a fun little performance. But David Alan Grier should be Santa, and it would be a fun movie. That could be the spin-off movie for the sequel they're going to make about Halloween, apparently. That'll be, that maybe that'll be Murphy's third one. Like, oh, let's just do this same premise, but with Halloween somehow.
Yeah, there's something to the, we'll talk about this again in a minute with this next movie, but there's something to the laziness of like just making a movie out of like a known entity and then just like dotting the T's and dotting the I's and crossing your T's on it, being like, well, all these movies have like a chase where you have to get something. So in this, why wouldn't it be five golden rings? So like them just kind of, it's like you're plugging in, it's like Mad Libs, kind of. It's like, yeah, you're writing a screenplay, but you're doing Mad Libs. And that's what this movie feels like. And it's what the next movie feels like. I think the next movie is more successful at the Mad Libs than this one. But Mark's going to disagree.
Oh, boy.
Anyway, I watched this back to back with Deck the Halls, which ended up being a bad idea because they're really similar. And I don't remember the differences. But like, it's kind of trying to be like an indictment of capitalism and how the holidays are all about who can spend the most money and who can have the most lavish Christmas display, and he has to learn to understand the true meaning of Christmas and love his family. It's all about winning. It's not about winning, oh blah. But the mischievous elf deal with the devil shit here is really particularly uninspired. Jillian Bell doesn't really get to do anything.
No.
And I'm just looking at my notes. I got nothing else. It's forgettable holiday fluff. I think the second movie eclipsed. I feel like before I watched the second movie, I was going to be kinder to this one, but I don't need to anymore. So
I'm trying to do the basic algebra on that. I'm giving this one 1.5. I'm trying to figure. I know where this is going. Right now, I'm just in terror of what this next conversation is going to be. So here we go. But yeah, I'm giving. Man. I can't decay like 1.5. You're giving it 2.
Two stars for Candy Cane Lane.
You're in the holiday spirit here, apparently.
Exactly. I'm very giving. Movie's all about people trying to get like $100,000 or something for a prize. It's very
with an asterisk that no one noticed. Yeah.
That was a funny gag, I guess.
Was it really though?
Again, no, lazy. But again, let's keep this conversation about lazy writing going as we talk about Family Switch on Netflix. Which, did you notice in the end credit blooper reel, they had like a, what do you call it, a clapboard thing in the bloopers that revealed the title used to be Family Leave. But I think it's a very it's a perfect Netflix algorithm thing to see that title change go from Family Leave, which doesn't tell you anything about it, to Family Switch, which tells you everything about it in the fucking title. It is the perfect Netflix movie. It is just Family Switch. What if a family switched? You've seen the movies. You've seen Freaky Friday. You've seen 13 Going on 30. You've seen Big. Yes, we'll reference all of those. Don't worry. You've seen them all. What if a whole family switched, including a dog and a baby? Is it a good idea? Here's the trailer coming at you, directed by McG.
I worry that we're all kind of disconnected.
Would you ask me something?
What?
It's fine. Okay, good night.
Do you think it's good for you to live like this?
What's up? You're really not supposed to use your hands.
Why am I family meeting downstairs? Let's go.
Can you help me with this problem? I'm kidding. You can't help me.
No, I can't.
We are going to make a happy memory as a family. I wish you could be me. I would love for you to be me for one day.
I would love for you to know what it's like to be me.
I would kill to eat a dozen donuts and just have it burn right off.
Would you take a picture of my family, please?
Everybody say Merry Christmas.
You get the idea. Jillian Bell as the magical Christmas elf has been replaced by Rita Moreno as the magical Christmas elf. Watching these back-to-back was a funny exercise because you really see the rubric or the outline of how they make these things. Like, they're very central. They're all the same, but it's funny that it took this long to get a Christmas themed body switch movie, because I feel like the Christmas magic bullshit excuse lends itself to the premise. Whereas like Freaky Friday, the remake, I remember, isn't it just like, we're in a Chinese restaurant and an earthquake happened and it's like some Chinese magic or something weird. So I appreciate that. Like, I think while very lazy, low effort, I think it's like almost a winning premise. I don't know, man. Let's get to it. Extremely low effort affair. Vaguely Christmassy reskin of a body swap movie. It's not one body swap. It's four. The kids swap with the adults. The baby is a dog. A CGI baby and a CGI dog. It looks terrible. It's not very funny. But I laughed a few times at this movie in spite of myself. Almost entirely thanks to the cast. I think Jennifer Garner's funny. I think Ed Helms is funny. I think the girl is funny. The boy is whatever. But my point is, Mark, you know, Freaky Friday, Big, whatever you want to call it, those hijinks have become a staple. It's become its own genre for a reason, because it allows for base silliness. Like, remember the Jumanji movies that we have now? Not the old one, but the new ones with The Rock. Those movies are just body swap movies. And all the comedy is like, Jack Black's talking like a girl. The Rock is Danny DeVito. Like, my point is, things can be uninspired and still like work and make you laugh. And this movie's very lowbrow. Like, it literally has a Chekhov's fart joke. They set it up early and then deliver on it. It's very lazy. Lots of the most obvious lazy jokes on earth, but it has a heart. There's a message about, you know, you're giving up like your dreams for your family and your kids not knowing that and kind of learning that and appreciating that. So I think parents would enjoy that. Like, I gave up my rock career for you. My band's huge. And the mom giving up a promotion to watch the kids. Maybe that's actually bad messaging. It says kids are going to ruin your life. But anyway, I found it to have heart. It made me laugh. Again, a movie I watched with my wife on the couch around the holidays. It's like a low bar, but I think this is perfectly fine. Watch at home with your family over the holiday fodder.
Wait, are you recommending this thing?
I am.
Oh my God. Okay.
Well, it's still a two and a half. It's still okay. A 2.5 on the 4 scale, but it's fully a 3 on the 5 scale for me.
If we're doing arithmetic or algebra,
yeah, like we get pedantic about these things. Let's do it.
We do, but this is so lazy. What about the performances is funny, other than the fact that it is Jennifer Garner and Ed Helms? That's it.
They're not doing anything. I am acknowledging that. One of the things my wife and I were joking about, I'm like, it's so funny how you don't really have to. Again, low effort in terms of the screenplay.
Yes, very low effort.
All you have to do is get stars, and you have this generic thing that an algorithm probably spit out. You wrote Freaky Friday, but it's a family. Baby switches with dog. And then they wrote this movie. Like, it truly feels like that. There's nothing inspired about it. But I think it's just interesting. Like, it's clearly made for two stars to come in and make it work. And I don't know if it 100% gets there. But like, it kind of does. It's fine.
I thought it was totally watchable
and fine. And like, it made me laugh, and it didn't make me cry or anything, but like, it resolved in a nice way. It was very, again, very low bar, and making clear that it's like a 2.5, not a 3. But if Mark gave it a 1, I think on his website.
I gave it a one. I really don't get.
And I hate Mick G. I fucking. He's not a good filmmaker. My point, I take issue with the fact more that like I have to think about Jennifer Garner on a set being like McG. Like, it's like beneath the dignity of these stars to have to talk to this fucking asshole and address him as McG. I think it's very silly. And he made two of the worst movies I've seen in recent years in The Babysitter and The Babysitter 2 on Netflix. But this was fine.
Oh my God. Anyway, okay. So wait. Okay, but there's like nothing to these characters. First off, I didn't buy the body swap gimmick at all. Yeah, they're archetypes, and which means like when they switch bodies, the performances to me didn't communicate how they switched. There's no personality to the characters enough for those switches to really be meaningful, except for now Ed Helms is talking like a
dork.
Yeah, that's it. And Jennifer Garner's talking like, you know, a teenager, and that's it. There's nothing to the characters, so I didn't find that funny. I didn't find it convincing. I think it's funny you didn't think dog and the baby humor was funny, because yes, the visual effects are terrible, but I think that's the only kind of funny joke in the movie, like, is that the baby and inspired, the dog switch places.
Yeah, it's kind of an inspired idea, sure.
But it is so lazy. It is inherently lazy. It is completely, yes. I don't like saying the AI algorithm thing spitting out a screenplay.
I know.
It really does feel that way here, because even the Christmas theme is like, it just pops up out of the blue in the opening and then at the end. And in between, it doesn't matter that it's Christmas.
No.
Because it really feels as if they reshot it when they realize, oh, this is going to come out like late November. We'd better make it a Christmas movie so they'll hit that algorithm.
And yeah.
It feels that way. It feels so cynical on that level. And it just feels cynical from the foundation that it is so lazy, that there's no characters, there's no jokes. It's all formula. It's all just, even the lessons are.
Yeah,
vague.
it's all the formula, it's but so, I think, I don't know. I can't explain why I walked away thinking that, because I don't want to like this shit. I didn't really like it. I didn't like it. It's definitely a teetering 2.5, 3. I can't bring myself to give it a 3 on this podcast, but like, it is, it's a rare 2.5, but I'm going to recommend it. I think people should watch it. I think it's. People should watch it, if only to tweet at us and comment on YouTube and on our podcast feed on Apple and Spotify about it. We have to settle the debate once and for all. This is our greatest Siskel and Ebert flap. Siskel and Ebert style flap yet.
Over this shit.
Over this fucking garbage directed by McG that I'm acknowledging isn't like good, but it's like an understanding the assignment thing. And I don't know. I did laugh at their stupid little riff about I'm 17 again. I'm 13 going on 30. Like, it's so low effort, and it's I'm annoyed that I laughed, but I did laugh enough to give it a letterbox pass, which is a 3 out of 5. That's what we're gonna call a letterbox pass, and a 2.5 on the Roger Ebert scale.
I'm giving it a 1. I'm one star. That's it. It's terrible.
You didn't appreciate that Weezer's in this?
No.
Okay, that's fair.
What song was it? I forgot already what song it was.
I forgot too. It's a Christmas song, but
yeah, Christmas
Rivers
song.
Cuomo shows up early and I'm like, oh, Weezer's in this. And then they play a song. Yeah, it's very algorithmic, but I don't know. I wonder if my wife wasn't in the room with me and we didn't have like a fun time watching it together, if I would have been as nice. But we thought it was fine. That's my review. Let's talk about a movie we'll agree on. Finally, Unity. Fallen Leaves. Here's the trailer.
Marjat pihlajain, kuin verta niillä ois. On kurkiaurat lentäneet jo ylipääni pois. Mukaan se ei luottaneet ne maihin kaukaisiin.
Tapasin sen pienemmän myöhemmin. Mentiin melkein naimisiin.
Miksi te menneet? Nätti likka. Hiljainen tosi.
Hukkasin puhelinnumeron.
Se kieltämättä vähän haittaa. Saat kelvata, vaikka näytätkin heiveröseltä.
En tiedä edes nimeäsi.
Kerron ensi kerralla.
Me la vie se pare, ce qui s'aime, tout doucement, sans faire.
This is a nice little
movie. Can I just say real quick, I love the movie so much because we just went from, you found something of value in Family Switch. We go from that to this Finnish deadpan satire of modern day life.
That's why this is the best podcast on fucking Earth.
Oh my God.
I agree.
Here we go. Okay, that's it. Continue. Yes.
I agree completely. This is a terrific podcast with a wide breadth of coverage. That's a good point, Mark. My friend actually texted me recently about this. He said, it really tickled me that at the end of this really thoughtful, long discussion on one of the best movies of the year, you guys are then like, and next week, Five Nights at Freddy's. That's range. So everyone agrees. That's why they're here. Thank you for listening. All right. Fallen Leaves. This Finnish movie from a Finnish director whose work I'm going to be honest, I am pretty unfamiliar with. I've seen, I don't think any besides this movie. This is my first. This movie is being touted as being a part of kind of like an informal trilogy with a couple of his other movies, The Match Factory Girl, and I Hired a Contract Killer, I believe, are the other two, from like between the 86 and 90, I think those came out. Anyway, this is a movie, Mark, I don't know how I would describe it. Romantic comedy sounds wrong, but it feels like it kind of is like one. But it's kind of, it's just like, deadpan was a good word you used up top. It's a movie that I would describe as, it's about the importance of finding pleasures in life and the simple pleasure of being in love, if you consider that simple, but like, or having a relationship or doing something for yourself and spending time with somebody else. It's in times of strife, because this movie, the first thing you hear, maybe not the first thing, but throughout the movie, you hear like the Ukraine war stuff going on in the background, and she's constantly turning the radio off and just going about her day or whatever. And I really appreciated that table setting, especially because I think you get at this in your review, Mark. This is a movie that feels like it could be a period piece for like 50 years ago, but it's not. It's actually in the future. It takes place in 2024, if you look at a calendar in the movie that they show you. So like, it's this really interesting movie that's kind of timeless and just goes, and like, it's about two people on the margins, like one who works as like a cleaner and the other guy who's just like a fucking alcoholic. That's all you really know about him. And it's about them connecting. But and then like this, you know, not disconnecting, but like not seeing each other for a long time, and they didn't get each other's numbers, and like fate brings them together again. And will they make it work? And it's just, it's so simple and there's not a lot going on, but I would argue it's actually is a deep movie in spite of that. Please talk about it better than I did.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's all about the tone. It's all about that feeling of just being bored and having that malaise of just existing, going from, you know, day-to-day job, going in between jobs. She loses her job as a grocery store clerk, or stock person, and he loses his job at the factory, and they have to just keep looking for new work, and they keep failing at doing this for a whole bunch of reasons. And then at some point they meet, and then they keep reuniting by fate, and it does feel a bit like a romantic comedy, but it's just these little tiny things. And it is that feeling of being overwhelmed in your own life and being overwhelmed by the world and how awful things can be, and looking for those little things that make it worthwhile. It is a very simple film, but I was caught up in it just because of one, the look of it. It does look like something out of time, even though it is modern and contemporary and deals with contemporary issues. But because it is out of time, it's like, well, we've always been dealing with this stuff, and we've always had to deal with terrible things in our own lives and terrible things in the world going on. And how do we get through that? And just that exploration of how do we find our way through a day-to-day life that feels so awful at times. I just was caught up in it. And I love the little details of the romantic comedy stuff and how it subverts it and how it embraces it. Yes. I don't want to say too much, but there's a coma involved at one point that is like something out of a goofy romantic comedy, but it works here because you're caught up in the lives of these characters because they feel so ordinary and routine. You're like, yeah, I get this. I understand this. I can relate to a lot of this stuff. And I was on board with it. So I enjoyed it.
And it has one of the best karaoke scenes of the year.
Yeah,
that scene in the bar, that song is so good. It's one of my favorite scenes of the year, probably. I love a karaoke scene. It's like, always gets me. And that's like a unique one because it's more just like a band scene. It's like a song, and it's really nice. Anyway, this movie features a couple going on a first date to see Jim Jarmusch's The Dead Don't Die, which it's amazing they survived that, because that is a bad movie, I thought. Did you like that movie?
No, I didn't like that one.
Okay, great.
Yeah, there we go.
I appreciated the nod to Jarmusch here. Feels like a kindred spirit of this director or something. But yeah, this movie made me very eager to dive into this guy's other films. I, you know, every now and then you find a blind spot as a cinephile and you feel like an idiot because you're like, where's this guy been all my life? Everyone's giving his movies 5 stars and I haven't seen any of them. So I feel like I'm excited to catch up. And this is a very good, very simple, nice movie that, yeah, it's about, you know, working minimum wage job in a tough time, and how what makes life worth living. I feel like it just it made me think about a lot of stuff. It was really good. Very, very strong 3 stars for Fallen Leaves.
3 stars for me too. That nice perfect blend of bitter and sweet here. It's just lovely at times. I really enjoyed that.
A lovely movie that will eventually be on Mubi streaming, yeah. I believe. And in theaters now, limited. All right, let's talk about Raging Grace.
You must be the new help.
Yes, ma'am.
Do try to remember that this is your place of work, not your home.
There are so many children back home that would be happy to have this.
Gloria.
Oh, Mr. Garrett, I'm Joy. This is my daughter.
Grace. I saw her in my dream. She tells me you've been caring for me.
I'm originally from the Philippines.
I love the Philippines. I once had a Filipino nanny.
That lady gave that old man the sleeping medicine.
Classic bad trailer that is overselling the horror elements for this movie that I think those horror elements are very much the worst part. I don't know if Mark agrees, but I'm gonna let him take it over. Tell me about this movie.
Yeah, so this is another in the trend of the life of a working undocumented migrant as a horror story. And I think this one works pretty well because it does, once again, like some of the better ones, it gets you involved in the life and the routine and the struggle of just having to keep under the radar and being insecure financially and in terms of housing. So the setup is this this woman who's a cleaner. She works for this cleaning company named after Rudyard Kipling, which becomes a big point in the movie later on. She's going house to house, keeping schedule of when her clients are going to be out on business or on vacation, and sleeps in the houses with her daughter and just cleans up after them. And then that's it. And that's how they're living, is just with that complete level of uncertainty. She gets this really good deal at this remote manor where she's going to get paid under the table, a lot of money. It's more than she can make. And she's trying to buy some forged documents for citizenship in the UK. And some creepy things happen in the house. And there's a lot of mystery going on. It's not much of a mystery, but a mystery of the man who is in a coma upstairs. And how did that happen? I enjoyed this because it's so nimble on its feet of swapping between those different genres of becoming like this slice of life thing and then turning into a thriller as she's trying to hide her daughter from the woman who's running the house at the time. And eventually to the horror stuff, which I guess it is like the least compelling aspect of it. But what I think works about it is that it is tied into the entire idea, not just of the life.
You're right. You're right.
This like underlying, you know, the obvious prejudices of the past that were there and how they're still there, but you have to look a little bit harder for them. But they're still present. And I liked the way that it just uncovers all those layers of those things, like having the Kipling references throughout the movie and having this character who is asleep. And yet once the plot awakens that prejudice, a certain character comes into play and becomes the secondary villain here. I just appreciated that as a metaphorical level, and how much it has to say, but while keeping it in tune with the characters and the story and staying true to those ideas. It's hard to talk about because there's a couple of twists, and two, we've seen a lot of movies like this as of late. And I think
Nanny, Nocebo, At the Gates. What else is there? Is that all of
them? Okay. There's probably a few more. We've talked a couple of times about undocumented migrant stories as horror movies.
And they feel they all feel like post Get Out, post Parasite in a certain way. You know what I mean? In terms of like telling this story via the horror. That's more Get Out, where I feel like what I'm trying to say is these movies feel like they have to Trojan horse their message or whatever it is into a horror movie to get it made. I feel like, you know what I mean? That's kind of how I feel like these movies operate, where like Nanny really felt that way, where like this is a good movie, but it feels like it has to throw in horror elements to get people to watch a trailer and go see it. And I felt that way. I do feel that way about this movie. And I agree that it has a lot to say and it's really interesting stuff. And I just think the horror elements didn't do anything for me, leave a lot to be desired. But the themes are very compelling and rich, and they do make it worthwhile ultimately. And you're right to say that the horror element is baked in, even if I didn't think it was effective. It is definitely baked into the premise. Like, you know, being a being an immigrant worker in the US without a green card, as a horror story makes sense. Like, I get it on paper. But yeah, I think it's just the scares thing and that framing that's keeping me from like loving this movie. But I thought it was very effective, and I agree, it's one of the better. It feels like it has the most to say out of those movies that are about like assimilating into the US and like losing your identity or becoming like a white person, so to speak, becoming more Americanized, losing touch with your family, and the insidious nature of well-meaning white people, so to speak. There's a lot going on.
And less than well-meaning white people,
oh, yeah,
too.
What's the bad meaning.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very.
I really like that juxtaposition of having two villains in this. So you see the modern day representation of what prejudice looks like, and then the old fashioned version that's, you know, looks a little bit more polite because they've been raised to be, you know, genteel and all that.
Exactly.
But you know what?
Right.
What's beneath that very thin surface? It's
the same hatred, the same. Yeah, exactly. You nailed it. That's exactly why it works. So I'm giving it I don't want to say generous 3 stars, but it is a 3-star movie that I think has some problems, but it's like it feels like I'm sure this is like a debut or something. It is a debut.
I think so. I think it's a feature debut at least.
It's a feature debut, and you know, you got to give it some leeway on that, right? So like, it's a three-star movie for me. With some caveats that I didn't love the horror elements. But again, I don't begrudge anybody for doing that, because I do think there's more, there's a reason the filmmakers is making a horror movie, because they want to get the story told or whatever. Are you 3 as well?
Yeah, I'm giving it 3 stars too. So, yep.
Totally
worthwhile.
Yes, definitely worth your time if you can find it. It's definitely a smaller release that's limited and maybe VOD, but keep an eye out. All right, this next one's a French movie with Isabelle Huppert. Never know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, despite having seen every one of her movies, I feel like, and seeing her in person several times in New York City at screenings. Not even going to try to correct myself. La Syndicaliste trailer. Here it is.
Une Kirnée s'est fait agresser chez elle. C'est quoi cette histoire?
Vous pensez quand même pas que j'y suis pour quelque chose?
Vous avez des ennemis?
Depuis un an, je travaille sur un dossier sensible chez Areva.
Vous pouvez nous en dire plus? Brody a fait des zingues à Areva. Il négocie avec les Chinois dans le dos du gouvernement.
Vous avez des preuves? Il veut devenir numéro 1 mondial du nucléaire. Si vous balancez ça, vous allez prendre des coups.
Excusez-moi pour le retard. Vous n'êtes pas convié.
Vos questions à la direction, vous gérez bien auprès du ministre. Vous vous prenez pour qui?
Faites attention. Il y a beaucoup de pression politique dans ce...
Watching that trailer, Mark, made me think this is kind of like the straight played version of the movie that May December is like making fun of, like a rip from the headlines story where the audience really just wants to know about the lurid details, like a knife was inserted into this woman's vagina or whatever, like all this thing that happens up top. But this movie is just kind of... it's another one where I'm torn, Mark, between 2.5 and 3, because I think the movie is a fine retelling of this story that I hadn't heard and then has since looked up and discovered the facts. And it's like an ongoing story that still isn't resolved. And I think that me just saying that sums up why this movie doesn't really 100% work for me. It just feels like a rip from the headlines, true story, like Law and Order episode type of thing. It feels very televisual. It does not feel cinematic to me. But despite having a great lead performance, take it away, Mark. What did you think of this movie?
Yeah, it does have that rip from the headlines feel. It has a lot of confusing French politics and the intersection of French government and industry, because it's about nuclear power in France.
Yeah, it's about like geopolitics also.
Yeah, so there's a lot of confusing stuff that I think a French audience will immediately understand what's going on, but you know, us meager Americans don't quite get it. But I was okay with not understanding it, because it is so much about once you kind of get a grip on, oh, this is how the layout of everything is, this is what the stakes are of this story, it turns into a completely different story that has really very little to do with nuclear power and with government influence and with secret meetings between the French embassy and China, or however it's all working out. That's not the actual thing, but you know, it's about a woman who's been abused by systems of power and by very particular attackers in her own home, and how the systems that are supposed to protect her end up failing her constantly and repeatedly.
Yes.
And that part of it is what drew me in. And the fact that Isabelle Huppert is so great in this role, as she typically is. But it's such an understated performance because this character is so driven. I think that's the important part of the first section of the film with all that, is just that you understand she is so determined and passionate about her work. And as soon as that attack happens, something flips and she's no longer passionate about the work. She's no longer determined. All of that has gone away because of what happened to her. And how does she reclaim that power that she has, that she once had, against the presence of these systems and these men and these departments that are working against her for whatever reason? I found that part compelling.
Yes. And there are some really great grace notes with exactly that, like the police not caring and turning her into turning her from victim into a suspect. Like, she gets this really invasive procedure post assault, and then it takes a couple seconds and the doctor is like, see, it was nothing. And it was like, to you, it was nothing. To her, it was traumatic. And it had like, it is good in that regard. You're right. I guess I underestimated in that regard, because it definitely nails all that. I'm just trying to think why it kind of landed with a thud more than like, I walked away going, I want to recommend that to people. It's just a little dry. It doesn't have much style to it. And it just feels like you're watching a thing that happened like recently. Not the most compelling presentation, but it's all well acted and well performed and well wrought. So I don't really know what my problem with it is, other than like, it kind of feels like a TV movie more than a cinema. You know what I mean?
No. Yeah. I get that part of it. It is pretty basic on a stylistic level, but Huppert is so good that I was caught up in it. And I think it has a lot to say about society and how women are treated and how society, just in general,
I wrote down the thing I bolded is, society loves to vilify a woman. They can't fucking wait to do it. And it just feels like a late Me Too movie, where like France didn't get around to the Me Too movement until like now because of the way that the French stereotype or whatever.
I wonder what it was, though. I wonder what it was that made this takes place, I think, in 2012 originally. I wonder what kind of dragged up.
Oh, I mean, I'm joking about them. I'm joking, but I'm also kind of like, that's probably what it was. Like, where did Roman Polanski run to when he committed sex crimes or whatever? Like, people go over there for a reason. Just saying, they're a little. I'm joking about the fact that like Americans are prude and the French are very sexual people. That's the joke we're making, but it's very, very rude. So
But I do wonder what about this case like 10 years later makes it, you know, worth. And maybe it's just because it has been 10 years. I don't know. It's interesting. It's a fascinating case because there's no solving what happened, and it's frightening when you think it on that level.
Yeah, you're right. I'll give it the three.
Okay,
cool.
I'll give it three.
It was good. It's a 2-hour movie that never bored me.
I'm giving it 3 stars too, and I'm happy I knocked your rating up just a little bit to the disappointed about Family Switch that I couldn't knock it.
You had no impact.
Led to the recommendation.
Yeah, no impact on Family Switch.
Oh boy.
We'll be back next week with.
A lot,
I think. Poor Things, I know, is out. What else is there? I'll have to go to markreviewsmovies.com, check the bottom. We've got Boy and the Heron. We've got Chicken Run 2. We've got the new Ava DuVernay. We've got a Shudder original. We've got that aforementioned Emma Stone, Yorgos Lanthimos, Poor Things. We've got a William Brent Bell horror movie in Lord of Misrule. There's a lot of stuff, and there's probably more. Thanks for listening. Alien Ant Farm.
The show starts in one.
Silence. Shut up. Ush.